The first level has been the topic of the first lecture, the local ectoposis with very special case, but not very different, the case of ectoposis over a topological space. Now I shall introduce a notion of sheaf on an arbitrary category, not just a local, not just a lattice. And in order to do that, I shall first revisit again the definition of sheaf on a local. What is a sheaf on a local? Well, you take elements ui, uj, and so on. You take the sheaf at those levels. You take an element ai here, an element aj at this level, and you want these to be compatible on the intersection. When you restrict them on the intersection, they become equal. So that's a compatible family, and then you must be able to glue that family. This can be done much simpler. Instead of giving a family of ui, uj, considering their intersections and so on, why don't we choose at one a family of ui stable for taking the down segment? I mean, if I take a ui, I take all the elements which are smaller than ui in my family. All the elements smaller than ui. All the elements smaller than uj. Then, in particular, I have taken ui intersection uj. Certainly, giving a family at the level of the ui uj is nothing more and nothing less than giving a family at all the elements smaller than ui and uj. If you have that element there, you have all the restrictions of this element. And saying that the family is compatible is precisely saying that you end up at the same place. So, if I take family of elements which are stable for the down segments, a compatible family along this UI, well, I no longer have to speak of the intersection. I take a compatible family along those UIs. Among these, I have the intersection, and of course, they are still compatible at the lower levels than the intersections. So we could decide to impose ourselves when we work with a covering to always take the covering of a family, but which is downward stable. But downward stable, that means just that you have a family which is a subfunctor of the representable functor. What is a subfunctor of the representable functor? Well, that's a family. If you have a representable functor, in order to have a subfunctor, every time you have an arrow, the composites have to be in the subfunctor. A subfunctor of a representable functor, it's a family of arrows which is stable for composition on the left or on the right, depending if you draw the picture or if you write down the formula. So that's what I have, and if I take a compatible family in F, well, this is just for each element here, giving an element in F. For each element chosen in the family, I give myself an element in the F of UI there. So, sheaf. F is a contravariant functor. Such that when I take a subfunctor of a representable functor, which is covering meaning that U is the joint of all the UI for which R of UI is not empty. It's a singleton. So this is the family of my UI. It's a covering of U. So the join of all the places where it is not empty, that's U. I take a covering subobject. When I take a compatible family in F, that's just a natural transformation. At each place where this one is not empty, I take an element of F. And since I have all the restrictions, that's at once a compatible family. And I must get a unique element of F of U by the Yoneda lemma, an element of F of U. That's a natural transformation from the representable functor to F. So I must have a unique morphism such that this commutes. So for every cover of U, which I now view as a subobject of the representable functor, and every morphism, every natural transformation to F, I must have a unique extension. If I have this, F is a sheaf on the local. Well, that's quite elegant as a definition, because if instead of taking a local distributive lattice or what with good properties, if I now take a category, well, to avoid logical problems, I shall take a small category. Just to avoid questions of size, I take a small category, and for every C, in C, I choose a set of subobjects. Of the representable functor, which I call covering. I choose arbitrarily subobjects of the representable functors, which I call covering subobjects. A sheaf is a contravariant functor to the category of sets, as before, a contravariant functor, with the property that every time I have something covering, and I have a natural transformation to F, there exists a unique extension. A sheaf, as before, it's a contravariant functor, which is orthogonal to all the covering subobjects. Every time I have a covering subobject and something defined on the subobject, I have a unique extension. Excellent idea. Well, it doesn't work. Just like when we pass from a topological space to a locale, I said, okay, let's work with a complete lattice. We repeat the idea that we had in the case of topological spaces. Oh, yes, but to be able to prove theorems, we have to be able to use specific properties which were valid for topological spaces, like the distributivity between intersection and unions. Well, here it is exactly the same thing. If you give coverings without any requirements on the choice of those coverings, there is little hope to mimic and extend what was going on in the case of a locale. And so, what should we require as axioms? Well, there is a first trivial axiom C. Well, the identity is covering. When I am in a locale, at an element U, U is a covering of itself. Okay. This should be the case. Now, in a locale, we had seen that it was important if we have a covering of something on a smaller level, we take the intersections, we keep a covering of the smaller level. A big union restricts as a union on something smaller. So, if you have something which is covering here, well, why should I write it like that? If I have something which is covering, and I go at a lower level, that means I have something like that, I pull back, taking the intersection, was taking the pullback, then this has to be covering. If I pull back something covering at a lower level, I must have something covering. The third axiom is more involved. Suppose you have something which is covering, and suppose you have another subobject. The idea will be, okay, you have this one. If I can pull it back, and if it can cover all the pieces of this covering, it should cover everything. If I have a covering of something, and if each piece of this covering is itself covered by something, putting everything together, I have a covering of the top. So this is what we can say, so we take all the morphisms which are in R, R1, R2, R3, like that. So we had, end up here in C bar C1, C, C2, C. So I take all the morphisms, let me write them correctly, CR1, R2, R3. So just for all the morphisms of R which are covering, I consider all those morphisms here. I have S which is there, and I pull it back everywhere. I pull back S along all those pieces. If all those pieces are covering, if all those pieces are covering, since that one here is covering, S must be covering. That's the last axiom. A cover of coverings is a covering. What I have described is what is called a Grothendieck topology. And so when I have a Grothendieck topology, well, when I take the category of sheaves, this is called a Grothendieck topos. And then the pair C with, well, let me say, let me write T for the set of all the covering cribbles is called a site. So this is the Grothendieck topology. So a small category provided with a Grothendieck topology, that is a family of subobjects of the representable, which are declared arbitrarily covering, but in such a way that those three axioms are satisfied, this is a Grothendieck topology, that's a site. The sheaves for such a situation constitute a category which is called a Grothendieck topos. I think that Grothendieck toposes will be probably the main topic of this week. So certainly, as we have seen, every local ectopos is a Grothendieck topos. We had a specific choice of covering in the locale. Now, let us view some other examples. And for that, I would like to show you the biggest and the smallest Grothendieck topology on C. Biggest topology, every subobject is covering. Since everything is covering, there is no doubt all the axioms are satisfied, since they explain always that something has to be covering. Everything is covering. So that's a topology. Fine, everything is covering. What is a sheaf? There are not many sheaves. Take a representable functor. All subobjects are covering. The empty subobject is covering. The empty subobject, the pre-sheaf, which is empty at all levels, it is covering. So, suppose that F is a sheaf. There is a mapping here, the inclusion of the empty functor in F. Because it is covering, there exists a unique morphism there, such that this commutes. Yeah. But every morphism here will make this diagram commutative because the diagram is defined on the empty functor. So this means that there is only one morphism from there to there. By the Yoneda lemma, F of C is a singleton. So if you take everything as being covering, there is one single sheaf, the constant functor on the singleton, because the empty subobject is covering. And the smallest topology, well, I have no choice, the identities have to be covering, that's required. I take only the identities as covering morphisms. Again, it's just stupid to observe that this is a Grothendieck topology. But what is a sheaf? when you have alpha to f, you must have a unique extension, of course. The unique extension is alpha, because you have the identity. So every f is a sheaf. You only have to extend alpha along the identity. So these are the two extreme examples. I remind you that in the case of a locale, we had observed that very trivially, the representable functors were sheaves. Yes?
Names
for these biggest and smallest topology? No, I do not think so. Probably you won't be we call discrete and indiscrete, but I have never seen a name because
trivial.
Yes, but I do not think there are specific names, which well-established specific names, because these topologies are not useful at all. But I wanted to give this example to make the parallel with what we have done in the case of locales. There, as an example, trivial example, we had the representable functors. Representable functors can very well be sheaves. Here is an example where the representable functors are sheaves, because all functors are sheaves. Here is an example where the representable functors are not sheaves. Well, except if the category is a one-point category. But the representable functors, as soon as you have somewhere two arrows, they are not sheaves. So they can be sheaves, and sometimes they are not. Now there is a proposition. Well, it's not very deep proposition, a little bit technical to prove, but just routine calculation. The Grothendieck topologies on C constitute a locale. So the intersection of two topologies is a topology. That's obvious to check. Well, but you can perform the join of the topologies, so you perform the union of those topologies, you have to saturate for the axioms, and you get the join. And if you observe that lattice of topologies that you have obtained, you can verify that it is a locale. And there exist biggest topology for which the representable functors are sheaves. That part is, as soon as you have observed that you can perform a join of Grothendieck topologies, it's fairly easy. There are topologies for which the representable functors are sheaves. You take the join of all these, and it's immediate to observe that the representable are still sheaves for that union. So there is a biggest topology for which the representable functors are sheaves, and that one has a name. That's called the canonical topology, which you can easily observe in the case of a locale, is the topology with which we have worked all the time. So that's a canonical topology on a small category, which in the case of a locale, well, gives back the usual theory of sheaves on a locale. But also on a locale, there can be other topologies, like this one, you know, or like that one. Those two exist also on the locale. They are uninteresting. So, but now, let's move to an important theorem, which, of course, since it is important, it is difficult, and since it is difficult, I shall not prove it. But I shall try to give you an idea of why it works, why it makes sense to look at such a result. So I have a site, a small category with a Grothendieck topology T. And I take the sheaves on T. Well, this is a full subcategory of what one generally calls the pre-sheaves on C, that is, all the functors from C up to Z. All functors without the gluing condition, without the sheaf condition, generally one calls them pre-sheaves. Just the contravariant functors. So this is a full subcategory. We have taken the natural transformation as morphisms. We would be interested to find an adjoint when we have a pre-sheaf. We would like to be able to construct the sheaf universally associated with it. How can we do that? If I have something covering my pre-sheaf P, I have an associated sheaf. I hope so. So, let me imagine that I have found the associated sheaf, that it exists. Then every time I have something here, okay, then I have a morphism from something covering, then I shall have a unique extension if the problem is solved. So, every morphism here will give me something there. Every F will give me an F prime, which is there. So this F prime, by the Yoneda lemma, this F prime is, by the Yoneda lemma, the same thing as an element of AP of C. A natural transformation here is, by the Yoneda lemma, an element of AP of C. And I have to do this for all coverings R. So I am tempted to say, okay, let me define AP of C to be the collimate of all the natural transformation from R to P for R covering so every time I have an F, I want to have something here. I want to do this for all possible R. So, well, let me take this collimate. I do it for all R and I take the collimate. And so every time I have such an F, I put an element here because I know there must be an element there. And let me hope it will work. It doesn't work. It doesn't work because if you study carefully what you have done, well, by doing this you have constructed something new, but there are some morphisms which will arrive in your A of P, which are not arising from an F. So you have constructed some new things, so you have to repeat the process. And so you guess you will have to repeat and repeat and repeat and repeat and repeat the process up to the moment where hopefully it will stop. You are lucky. If you do it a second time, it works. So after one time, you have here some morphisms which do not arise from an F. And so you repeat because you have to add those things. And then you expect that in AA of P, you will have new morphisms to AA of P which are not arising from morphism to A of P. No, you don't. After two steps, it works. So the adjoint is just twice the construction I have given. That's not obvious to prove. But, if you take covering cribbles, we have seen one of the axioms tells you that there is a stability under pullbacks, from which it follows at once, that's trivial, that the intersection of two covering subobjects is still covering. The intersection of two covering subobjects is still covering. So if I have a covering subobject and there's a covering subobject, somewhere further in my collimate, I have the intersection of these two things. Oh ho! Here it is contravariant in this variable. So I have R, I have S, and somewhere in my collimate, I shall have the intersection. Somewhere in my collimate. This means that the collimate is filtered. When I have two steps in my collimate, there is a further step in which both are going. The collimate is filtered. Yeah, it's a collimate of sets. In the category of sets, filtered collimates commute with finite limits. So this functor A commutes with finite limits because it is constructed using a filtered collimate of sets. So it preserves finite limits. So this one preserves finite limits. So this one preserves finite limits. So this is a very, very important result. The inclusion of sheaves in pre-sheaves has a left adjoint, and this adjoint preserves finite limits. What can we infer from that? Well, a lot of things. This tells me that a lot of properties which are known to be true in the category of sets will automatically be true in a Grothendieck topos. We are in sets. For example, well, we had this property that finite limits commute with filtered collimates. Of course, collimates exist in a topos of sheaves because it's a full reflective subcategory of a category which is complete and co-complete, so it is complete and co-complete. So there is no point about that. But in set, finite limits commute with filtered collimates. Okay, But then, in C of SAT, also. Because in a category of functors to SAT, limits and co-limits are computed pointwise. Pointwise they commute, so those limits commute. There is nothing to prove. And in sheaves, CT, also, how do you compute the limits and the collimits? Well, finite limits and filtered collimits, they commute here, and they are preserved when you pass to the sheaves. So automatically, those things are preserved. Ah, a special property of infinite limits in pre-sheaves has no reason to pass over to the sheaves, because this functor doesn't preserve limits, but it preserves finite limits. So it's a property about finite limits and filtered collimits. It preserves finite limits. Of course, it preserves all collimits, because it's an adjoint. It has a right adjoint. So you have this property in the category of sheaves. Another property that you have in sets. If you have a collimit, if you have B, an arbitrary mapping, and you take the pullbacks, you pull back that collimit over B, you get a collimit. Collimits in set are universal. If you have a collimit, you pull it back over whatever you want, the diagram that you get here is still a collimit. This is true in the category of sets. So this is true in the category of functors to sets, because pullbacks and collimits are computed pointwise. Oh, but pullbacks and collimits are preserved when passing to sheaves. So the property is true in the category of sheaves. Allez, still a last example. If you take the coproduct of two sets, this is just a disjoint union. The two canonical morphisms to the disjoint unions are monomorphism. And the intersection of those two is zero. You perform the disjoint union, saying precisely that the union is disjoint, well, it's saying that the intersection of the two pieces is zero. Okay, this is true in sets, so this is true in the pre-sheaves. So this is true in sheaves, because it's a property again which goes about coproducts, that's a collimit, pullback, that's a finite limit, zero, well, that's a collimit of the empty functor, and being a monomorphism is a limit property. Being a monomorphism, U is a monomorphism precisely when the pullback with itself is the identity. So all these properties carry over to all pre-sheaves, thus carry over to the sheaves, because, again, that functor preserves all collimits and finite limits. So in that way, you can infer a lot of limits. You can prove a property like the topos, the Grothendieck topos, is a regular category, for example, regular category, meaning that when you have a morphism, you can always factor it as a coequalizer followed by a monomorphism. Well, again, it is something that you can do in SAT. So, while coequalizers and monomorphism are computed in the same way in the category of pre-sheaves, and this is preserved by the associated sheaf functor, and so this work in a Grothendieck topos. So all those properties, all those, let me say, exactness properties that you are used to consider in the case of sets, they carry over to every Grothendieck topos just because the associated sheaf functor preserves finite limits. Fine. I have to keep this in front of the camera. Now I would like to conclude by showing you that the last properties I was mentioning in the case of local ectoposes carry over to the topos of sheaves, to the Grothendieck topos, namely being Cartesian closed and having a subobject classifier. Cartesian closed, again, that's fairly easy. If you have three sheaves, if you have to prove that it is possible to find, it is possible to construct such a sheaf in order to provide a right adjoint to the product. Well, let us do it in the case of pre-sheaves, just ordinary functors, not sheaves. We have seen that pre-sheaves constitute a topos, that they are the topos of sheaves for the smallest topology where only the identity is covering. Well, that's again the same thing as for locals. The value at an object C should be, by the Yoneda lemma, the natural transformation like that. And so if we want the property to be true, we have no choice. We must take this to be the natural transformation . So you take this as a definition. You define H power G of C is the set of natural transformation over there. And you just check, it is routine, that it works perfectly well in the case of pre-sheaves. And then you will observe that your construction, if you take two sheaves, it's not even necessary to take two sheaves. If H is a sheaf, H power G automatically is a sheaf, and so the same construction works perfectly well for sheaves. That's the point for sheaves. Now, the subobject classifier. For pre-sheaves. Well, I would like to have a subobject classifier, which I keep calling omega, at an object C by the Yoneda lemma. It is that. But if I have a subobject classifier, the morphisms there classify exactly the subobject. A subobject classifier, it's something like that, suggest every subobject has a characteristic mapping, and I recapture the subobject by pullback. So the morphism there must be the subobject of that. So this must be the subobject of this. I have no choice. And the choice works perfectly well. It's definitely routine to check, in the case of pre-sheaf, that this works. That you get, like that, a subobject classifier. Okay. Are we lucky that it will work as well for sheaf, like Cartesian closedness? No. Omega is not a sheaf. Omega is not a sheaf. And in fact, in the case of sheaves, there is another phenomena. Well, take a subobject even in the case of free sheaves. Right, take a sub-free sheaf. And I have a Grothendieck topology. As we have seen before, I could take an element A in A of C and ask myself the question, is it in S? Maybe not. But at some levels, at some of its restriction can lie in S. If A is a sheaf, and if I have an element which lies in S at all places of a covering, and is S, if S is a sheaf, then the gluing is in S. So if I have a covering, and if everywhere along that covering A is in S, provided S is a sheaf, the gluing will be in S, A will already be in S. When you have a sheaf, being in S is the same thing as being in there along a covering, because you have the gluing property. But if S is not a sheaf, if S is not a sheaf, no. Then maybe if S is not a sheaf, I want to construct something bigger, S bar, those elements of A of C, which are in S along all elements, along a covering, let me say. So I have an element at the level C. It is not in S, but I have a covering of the level C, and when I look at all the pieces of the covering, it becomes in S. But it has no reason to be in S because S is not a sheaf. But okay, this element should be in S. Unfortunately, it is not. So I edit, I call this the closure. I take all those elements which are not in S maybe, but which are locally in S. That's the closure. So I get a closure operator, and if I have a closure operator, of course, I have a notion of closed subobject, a subobject which is equal to its closure, of dense subobject, a subobject whose closure is everything, and so on. And the trick is that the omega object for sheaves is a set of, so at the level C, is a set of closed subobjects of the representable. So, as we have seen, when S is a sheaf, it is automatically closed because something which is in it locally is in it. If it is not a sheaf, it has a closure. This is done for every pre-sheaf. So as pre-sheaf, I take the representable, and now I take for omega the closed subobject. So again, I have the truth mapping which picks up the biggest element. Well, of course, the biggest element, the representable functor, is closed in itself, of course. There is nothing bigger, so it is equal to its closure. So I take the top element, and if I have a subsheaf, I can take the characteristic mapping, so I go and take the place, you know, the element A, I go to the biggest place where it lies in S, and this is a closed subobject. Because I have a sheaf, we have seen sheaves are closed, and then I can define the characteristic mapping in that way. So I still have that property in the case of Grothendieck topos, I have a classifying object, something which classifies the subobject, but it is not the set of subobjects, but the set of closed subobjects of the representables. And maybe let me just make a last observation, since we are speaking about subobjects. The subsheaves of a sheaf constitute always a locale. Again, it's a property which is fairly easy to prove because it's the case in sets. The subobject of an object, well, constitute even a complete Boolean algebra. So arbitrary intersection distribute over arbitrary unions. So the same thing holds in pre-sheaves. And then you switch back to sheaves. Oh, as far as intersection are concerned, you have to limit yourself to finite intersections because the associated sheaf functor preserves only finite limits as finite intersection. So you get that finite intersections of subobjects commute with arbitrary union of subobjects. So the lattices of subobjects are locals. So this was a short introduction to Grothendieck topos, and I think that Laurent, after the coffee break, will go much, much deeper in the theory of Grothendieck toposes. Yeah.